Hey guys, this is Stefan from Nedermir, and today my guest is Erich Nachbar. Hey Erich.
Hello.
So Erich, can you introduce yourself and the brew you brought with you? Because today is, that's why we meet, the big data brew.
So I thought we'd start with a classic German
with a lemonade?
Summertime drink.
Okay.
So essentially, something you would drink, you know, while gardening, or maybe, you know, sitting in the beer garden. So it's supposed to be light, and I couldn't find the proper lemonade. Typically it's more like a little different lemon flavor, but I guess we'll have to do with the Italian.
So what is this all about?
And so essentially, you know, you just mix it pretty much half-half, or if you're an alcoholic, you can get a little more of the beer in, but just mix it and enjoy.
Okay. And any specific like ratio?
Yeah, I guess the typical thing is half-half. You know, you can do a little more of the beer in case you
We trained the two minutes.
That's why he's a kung fu in big data.
Yeah, alright. Good. That looks refreshing.
Okay, so let's
cheers.
Cheers.
Oh, very refreshing.
Yeah, almost good.
So, why don't you talk a little bit about your refreshing projects you did in the last few years in the big data space?
Yeah, so traditionally I've been doing data warehousing using Oracle databases, and at the point that was like, I'd say like 2005, if you would ask anyone, hey, you know, I have a lot of data, how do I do it? They would say, yeah, buy a big database like a DB2 Oracle, and then just buy a filer from EMC or, you know, NetApp. And then essentially, you know, you do your SQL queries, it comes back, you have your typical, you know, processing, and then you push it back in. And essentially, that's all nice and dandy, except that you end up spending a lot of money, and a lot of the problematic areas like I/O are actually not addressed. So typically you go over fiber channel, and it's fairly limited and expensive what you can do with it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, when, you know, I worked for Carrier IQ, I always felt like the system was holding us back to a certain degree. So we couldn't essentially, you know, cram enough analytics, you know, analytics deep thought into a night with all the data we were getting in from the devices. And so it seems like
what are they doing?
So the idea was essentially to turn everyone's cell phone into a sensor or a probe. So the idea being, let's say I drive down 101 and suddenly I drop my call.
Mm-hmm.
So traditionally what the carriers have been doing is they have about, for example, Sprint has I think around 300 trucks. They have cell phones mounted, they just drive throughout the US and trying to find dead spots. And of course it's fairly inefficient, and the US is big, so 300 trucks is, if you think about it, all not that big.
Mm-hmm.
And so the idea was that, hey, everyone has a cell phone in their pocket, why can't the cell phone report if someone actually encounters a problem?
Mm-hmm.
And so we were essentially, you know, we had a special firmware on the phone that would upload, you know, to the server when such an event would occur.
Mm-hmm.
So it was all centered around basically reception and, you know, problematic cell phone experience, like the battery of the cell phone is dead, why can't the carrier just send you a new one?
Yeah.
If you're a good customer.
Yeah.
And so this data was essentially uploaded every night, and then we had to, you know, crunch through the data and you know, find these problematic areas. And so there's a fair amount of you know, thinking that goes into the process, because let's say I take my cell phone and throw it in the glove compartment and close it, then it might lose reception. So I have to find and isolate those problematic events from systemic big large problems, like everyone is dropping a call in that area, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we bought the typical Oracle, you know, I think EMC Clarion, and we're doing the typical ETL processing, and we're just frankly running out of hours in the day to process the data.
Yeah.
And so once you spend, you know, $500,000 just for that, and it becomes kind of frustrating just tuning SQL queries and moving arguments in the work laws around, and you feel like your engineering resources are just being abused for, you know, childish yeah. things like moving work clauses around to convince the Oracle optimizer to run properly with it.
Yeah.
And so I started looking at other things, and that was in 2007. And, you know, I met Stefan at the first Hadoop meetup. So I was organizing the first few meetups before Yahoo took over.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it was a fairly tight-knit group at that time. And we actually worked on a little project, I guess, sort of, you know, building prototypes for Care IQ to just showcase that you can actually do it without Oracle. Because at that time, it wasn't like, oh, you have big data, just go to Hadoop. It wasn't really the clear choice at mm-hmm. that time. It was rather experimental.
Yeah.
And so I guess after, you know, that started working, I was writing for the third largest social network. I was writing the anti-spam filter.
Mm-hmm.
And it was also using Hadoop to basically crawl links and classify web pages.
That sounds like a fun job.
Yeah, there was a lot of quality control. A lot of quality control. It was questionable, very questionable websites.
Yeah.
Learned a lot about subcultures. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, moved on. I ended up, you know, also funny story that, you know, Stefan met the co-founders of Quantifind, and he basically said he's going to start this thing called Datamere. And if that, you know, is happening to work out, which it seems, then I can basically, you know, really, you know, be working at Quantifind. And so basically...
What's Quantifind doing?
So Quantifind, company I work for, is doing... Essentially, we built mathematical models that can help you forecast. Mm-hmm. So the idea is, one of the big vertical that we're in is pretty much all Hollywood movies that you see currently coming out.
You have to do quality control there too?
We do as team events, unfortunately. We don't get any private screenings.
Okay.
But what we do is essentially we would suck in all comments about movies that have been made in the last 5 years,
mm-hmm.
and then we would build mathematical models, and we can actually predict based on what people say how much money the movie is going to make.
Oh wow! Mm-hmm.
Plus, we essentially know if someone is intentful. So, you know, on the internet, everyone has an opinion, and most opinions unfortunately don't count because mm-hmm. they will never buy that product, see that movie, and so. We can actually tell based on the comment if that person is going to be intentful. So we know their interests and historically if that person would matter or not in terms of ticket sales.
Yeah, and I assume this is all Hadoop as well.
So funny story. So the thing with that particular processing is that it's not really big data. You're talking on the order of maybe 10 terabytes, maybe a little bit less.
Mm-hmm.
But the interesting thing is it's very CPU heavy because you run essentially, you know, optimizations over data.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we actually found ourselves is we're more big CPU and not big data because mm-hmm. 10 terabytes is probably not really what qualifies mm-hmm. for big data. And so you would see our machines, you know, completely, you know, pegged, you know, the CPU pegged for maybe, you know, 6 hours. Because we essentially can load that data into RAM and then essentially process the data without touching the disk, really.
Mm-hmm.
And so we run that on Spark.
Mm-hmm. Tell me more about Spark. I mean, you spend a lot of time with Spark. Help us to understand
sure.
maybe, you know, what's the architecture, what's the moving mm-hmm. pieces, why do you like Spark? And if you like to, you know, there's Marcos,
sure.
there's a chalkboard, so feel free. But so how did you get to Spark and what is exciting
so I met Matej, who is the main contributor or the founder of Spark at one of the Hadoop meetups, where essentially, you know, he was just, you know, showcasing his project. So he's you know, he used to be a grad student out of Berkeley,
mm-hmm.
UC Berkeley, and that was his project. And so at that time, or it still is fairly small, so it was, I think, on the order of like 15,000 lines of Scala code.
Mm-hmm.
And so he thought, what if I could give essentially people the option of either, you know, process my data similar to Hadoop, where I like load something from disk, do the processing, spill it back,
mm-hmm.
or I can say, hey, you know what, if you have enough RAM, you can also just say, hey, cache this particular data set in memory,
mm-hmm.
and then apply these operations in memory.
Mm-hmm.
And so it works sort of in both ways. And so what essentially what he did to sort of ease the transition is he's essentially building everything on top of he has basically HDFS as like the basis. So you can use pretty much any input format as mm-hmm. like the
your source.
But it's a Hadoop input format to get the key value tuples.
Yeah, okay. Correct. Mm-hmm. And so, and you know, they can process JSON files, but the point is that, you know, in our case, for example, we run this on MapR. So, but you know, any Hadoop distribution would actually do. And then on top of it, typically you.
So why are you using MapR?
Well, if you look at the other distribution, MapR, I think has a pretty kick-ass file system. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you can NFS mount it on the data scientist boxes and just access the data. It's obviously limited to, you know, the speed of the network interface, which is not suitable for large amounts of data, but it's good enough if the data scientists say, hey, I want to just like poke at this data, load it in R, and then play around with. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I interrupted you.
So sure, that's fine.
MapR, HDFS, and then input format.
Yeah, and so essentially what you would do is you would co-locate, you know, like in good old Hadoop fashion, the data nodes would be co-located with the Spark workers.
Okay.
And so essentially what you would have is, well, this is kind of weird because I'm, you know, I'm sort of mixing physical with logical. So, you know, if you would say this is a data node, you would, you know, run your Spark worker in here, and so you would get data locality essentially. So, you know, through the input format, the IP address, it would actually find out. So you would get the same locality advantages that you have with Hadoop. And then
Spark then directly the data, the Spark worker directly integrates with the data node, or how is it getting the data locality thing?
Correct. So you would install them on the same box.
Okay, but then you're accessing HDFS in the same. Mm. Let me think about this. How you integrate that then with the drop name node?
Well, so the name
is
node
is bypassing and just straight going after.
Yeah, the name node is really just, you know, it would find out where the blocks are located, and then it would schedule the jobs on the. It works very much similar to what the task tracker would do.
Yeah. Okay.
It's pretty much the same thing.
But then they basically just implemented kind of a fake task tracker.
It's their own task tracker. So really, you would only use the file system. You wouldn't use any of the job task trackers of
Hadoop.
Because
the APIs itself for Hadoop are not really open for this, right? So to access data locality, so I guess they just fake the whole thing.
Yeah, I think you can actually get.
Yeah?
I think you can get to it. I thought so. Yeah, I thought so.
All right.
And it seems to work. It seems to work.
It seems to work.
Yeah. Cool. And you've also Spark Master. It sort of, you know, has a little web UI that.
And then you push your jobs to Spark Master and it distributes to all the Spark.
Yeah, the rest works really pretty much the exact same thing. So the one of the big differences that they do that is very impressive is if you look at.
Let's not forget to drink. No. Cheers.
Cheers.
I got enough. Yeah, cool.
So one of the cool things that Spark actually does is, you know, when you're in Hadoop land, you have a jar that is your job, and you push it out, gets pushed out to all the nodes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you have a larger job that, you know, causes for some overhead.
Yeah.
And so what Spark does is, let's say I have a map operation. So I have, you know, let's say I have a collection and I saw dot map. So I'm running a map operation on it. Mm-hmm. I could basically say, you know, let's say this is my record. So this is a Scala code record. And I say, I don't know what I would do with it. I would say record times two. So this would, you know, since it's functional programming, it would actually, this result would be emitted as the result of that operation. And so
finally closures.
And so what it actually does, it serializes only the bytecode for that closure and pushes that out to the nodes.
Okay.
So we actually, it was so interactive that we actually drove for, you know, so prototyping purpose, we drove actually our customer front end through running jobs.
Okay.
Because starting a job takes maybe half a second, even less than that, because it's really efficient about like what it actually pushes out to the node. And then when you have it in memory, you really just you know, run it whatever it is in your.
So you kept all the data in memory all the time then?
Yeah. Okay. And so I mean, clearly, like I said, this is if you have a big CPU problem, this is great, and if you can afford the RAM.
Right.
If you have petabytes of data,
capital, right? So.
Exactly. And we are not an Amazon, so we can afford.
Oh, so you run this. So talk a little bit about why would you not run this in Amazon?
So the funny story is basically every time a new engineer shows up, it's like, okay,
so how can I get to our Amazon instance? And I said, okay, we don't run on Amazon. And then, you know, the big question mark comes up. It's like, why do you not run on Amazon?
Oh my God, every cool company runs on Amazon.
I know. And Mark Andreessen said also, everyone runs on Amazon. So, if you just open up, you know, Google spreadsheets or Excel, and you just do like a simple basic calculation, which I did. Unfortunately, I could never make the numbers work in favor of EC2. Never. Mm-hmm. And so I computed that in our case.
Is that a general thing, or is that just for Spark?
So I believe it's the general thing. So what I did, I really tried best case. So in my case, I knew that I can, let's say I keep the data in Amazon someplace. Mm-hmm. I don't pay for it even.
Yeah.
And then I fire up the nodes for 5 hours to run our nightly job. Mm-hmm. I have the same capacity like the nodes that we have currently, mm-hmm. Which would amount to like $400 a night in EC2. I mean, I would own those nodes very, very quickly.
Yeah, I see. Mm-hmm.
And our infrastructure is sort of a little bit built like Google, where, you know, even the machines, some of the machines don't have dual power supplies. It is made in a way that for certain things, SLAs can be lower because we can accept an outage. And for the stuff that we can't, we have everything redundant.
Yeah.
So dual firewalls, dual internet connections, you know, dual front ends, dual back ends, you know, blah, blah, blah. And so, and we're just never in the data center. Hmm. So it's, I know it sounds crazy, but.
Yeah. Let's talk a little about Scala and your experience about this. I mean, that's pretty crazy to use such a slow language for CPU intense. Trying to be controversial here. So what's your experience with that? I mean, it sounds like it's pretty, you know, flexible nature on the development side, and you can, you know, closures. I mean, Jesus. Larry, please push for closures in Java, finally.
I hope so.
Yeah, but so what's your, I mean, especially also since you CTO there, especially around the challenges of managing multiple development environments and onboarding people on a new language, but also on like your experience, how stable Scala is and so on.
So good question. I mean, so initially we really only tried, we were a Java shop, so, and we only tried Scala because at that point Spark required it. Mm-hmm. So by now you have, I think, Python and straight Java interfaces, so you don't have to anymore. But essentially, we sort of really got convinced by writing these jobs in Spark, and they look similar to like the Hadoop equivalent. What is that called? The Scalatra. It's not Scalatra.
Okay.
It's a Twitter framework.
Okay. Wow.
And so it looks kind of similar. So you can run the same style processing also on Hadoop. Mm-hmm. And what we actually found out is that. It's not good for people that are struggling to, you know, grok Java.
Mm-hmm.
They are probably overwhelmed by what you can do with it.
Mm-hmm.
However, if you have a really, really good developer, then they will find themselves writing about maybe a tenth of the lines of code.
Mm-hmm.
Because as you can tell, I mean, in Java, just this operation, you would have had probably a for loop, an iterator, you would have, you know, quite a few things you would need to do to achieve the same thing that I did in like with 3 lines of code.
So closures would be the trick for Java, yeah?
Oh, yeah. No, seriously. I mean, and you know, it's I think unfortunate that Java's gotten so big and Oracle is probably not helping either, that everything just takes so long with the committee process to just go anywhere.
Yeah,
it's too bad. But the runtime we actually found was basically the same.
Yeah.
So I think it's a little different when you go to like, you know, Clojure, the language, where the, you know, where the actual, you know, concepts are a little different. So this one, you can actually write object-oriented or functional code.
Mm-hmm.
And so this was functionalist style where, you know, this evaluates to an output.
Mm-hmm.
But we found actually very little runtime difference in our case.
Okay.
And so by now, we are not just writing all the Spark jobs in Scala, but basically the entire system is all in Scala now.
Cool. In Scala, you know, I mean, my favorite topic, I'm always getting, you know, rotten eggs thrown after me, is inversion of control, right? Flexibility, platform flexibility.
Mm-hmm.
Is Scala helping with that? I mean, I assume closures make that super modular and nicely decoupled, but Any specific
and so
thing
by,
that you took away?
So by platform flexibility, you mean?
Well, you know, really being able to say, okay, I want to implement a different transport protocol. Right, so the classical problem in Hadoop, it's all such a closed, coupled environment that if someone comes along and say, hey, I really would like to have encrypted communication between the nodes, that you can't do that. Or, you know, I run into problems once where I tried to use the Hadoop RPC and implement an object pool, and I couldn't make it work because I didn't have a on-send handler, and it's all private classes, methods, so you can't overwrite them any.
Yep.
So is Scala helping with that? I think you can even at runtime overwrite methods in Scala, is that right?
Well, there's a concept of a trait.
Mm-hmm.
So a trait is essentially you can overlay code plus member variables on top of an existing class.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's the concept of stackable traits where, you know, sometimes it's being used to sort of compose classes by just overlaying these things.
I think you have that in C# too, right? That's kind of how all the cool plugins for
Ruby has a similar concept.
Yeah.
And I do have to say, I think this is the first time that I see object orientation, sort of the promise of reuse being actually come to there's a tool offered that actually makes this more, I guess, achievable.
What IDE did you guys use for Scala? That was one of my challenges. You basically end up with,
By now, IntelliJ is very, very nice.
Yeah, okay.
Eclipse is the official one, you know, the Scala.
Okay.
Scala.
Did they get it fixed?
It had some rough edges, yeah. But by now it's actually pretty good. We don't really have any problems anymore. I mean, yeah, it's pretty good. I mean,
what's your favorite IDE?
We use IntelliJ, or I use IntelliJ.
Yeah. I used to be a big Eclipse fan, but it's just maybe got too big and too complicated, and now more and more of our engineers switching to.
Yeah, it was just getting too slow for us for some reason.
Yeah, you would think with the native RAM user interface, yeah.
And it was not getting any faster.
Man, those Russians, they really figured it out, huh?
Yeah, and we use the community edition, and it works really well.
Interesting.
And yeah.
So what's next in big CPU and big data land? What do you think? What's the next big thing?
Well, so one of the things that sort of these guys are starting to, if you look at the typical record that you have, if you have a record. I guess someone has to read this eventually, with first name and last name and zip. If you flip this around and say, okay, I have first name, and you treat this, you basically flip it around and make it column oriented, then if you have, for example, values like, 1, 2, 4, 2, then there's a great opportunity for compression.
Mm-hmm.
And so if I've how many different first names do you have? I mean, there are 65,000, words in the English language. There are probably not that many names. And so.
Hey, but you can now call your kids, what is it, Northwest? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Would not work in Germany, correct?
No, would not work in Germany.
They would tell you what the heck is going on.
No, go to Southeast.
Yeah. And so, by doing this column oriented, if you have this in memory, you get 20x plus compression.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's even faster because you don't even have to scan. You can just say the next 1,000 columns are exactly this value. So I don't have to even go over them. I can just,
you just
know. And so, and this is nothing new. I mean, plenty of databases have that. I don't know if there's a Hadoop format that does it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. But the point is that if you flip it around and make things column oriented and put them in memory, then you sort of get a nice, you have the best of both worlds. You can keep maybe 20 times, I think that's some like what people quote in terms of like the increase of RAM. So instead of like, one gigabyte of memory can hold 20 gigabyte of real world data. Mm-hmm. Plus if I, like a lot of these data warehousing, they say, oh, I want first name and zip for whatever reason. So I really don't have to, spend IO to essentially skip over last name in my case. And so a lot of databases have that, and I think the Spark guys, they have ideas as well to go there.
Cool. Interesting.
And so that's what is exciting.
So as a big data veteran and CTO of many companies that work in the space. What is what's your recommendation to people that get into big CPU or big data?
Big CPU.
Yeah, you know, I mean, what's the, and there's a lot of noise in the market.
Yeah.
How you cut through all of this? What's really interesting, and how do you approach all of this with reasonable enough effort?
So what I always like to do is, you know, I mean, I did consulting for about 8 years through a system integrator.
Mm-hmm.
And so you end up with these companies that have like an architecture committee, and then the architecture committee,
awesome. I
know, read papers, and then they have like a questionnaire, and then they grade these, you know, white papers of different vendors,
mm-hmm.
and then just fill in, you know, they grade them without ever having used it, and then they come, a number pops out, and this is the one we're buying.
Yeah, that's with the highest score.
Correct. And
yeah.
So that's a surefire way to buy something that doesn't work.
Yeah.
And so what I would say, it really doesn't matter, you know, whether you use Hadoop, Spark, anything else, but basically by now it's not a problem to obviously download it and try it.
Yeah.
And the trying it typically takes less time than, you know, talking about it for weeks. Just download it and try it and make a little use case for yourself, and then you'll probably have a much better understanding of the actual thing than anyone who just reads white papers.
Don't talk, just do.
Exactly.
Well, Eric, thank you very much for the nice summer drink.
And you're welcome.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Oder Prost.
Prost.